Good morning and welcome to the Salvation Army here at Croydon Citadel in this time of reflections. And I hope you're going to enjoy some of the worship, some of the music, the Bible reading, the Bible thought, and have that opportunity to reflect for yourself today, to grow in your spiritual understanding and maturity.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord.
From 2 Peter chapter 1, beginning to read at verse 3. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to kindness love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. If I was to ask you to describe yourself in just three words, what words would you use? Obviously, for myself, I would use good-looking, charismatic, young. Well, maybe not. But I guess that many of us, if not all of us, would want to use words that are surrounded by reliable, honesty, integrity. Do you see yourself as honest? Do you see yourself with integrity? Sometimes on our journey of spiritual growth, of spiritual maturity, of spiritual depth, we need to be challenged about ourselves. Many of us wear glasses. To be honest, to be totally frank, if I wasn't wearing my glasses, I wouldn't be able to read the sermon notes that are in front of me this morning. My glasses correct my vision and the flaws that I have when I see things. And a vision of ourselves needs to be correct. We need to be self-honest. The Bible shows a picture about someone who was worried about a speck of grit, a speck of dust in their friend's eye, without getting rid of a log that was in their own eye. Matthew 7, verses 3 to 5. When we're honest with ourselves, when, as the Bible challenges us to, we look at ourselves with sober judgment, then we can be an influence that speaks the truth in love. The New Living Translation says, "Let the words of Christ in all their richness live in your hearts and make you wise." Use his words to teach and counsel each other. Some Christians can be intellectually lazy, preferring to let someone else handle truth for them. They find the work of studying scripture is difficult, or how thinking through what God desires of them, of learning how to navigate the road of life through trials and temptations, practical and pragmatic theology, difficult. So they choose to lose themselves in trivia, in things that have no or little consequence. And there are also Christians who fear asking questions, as though asking a question is implicitly about doubt or is implying a lack of faith. In the Bible reading we shared earlier, 2 Peter chapter 1, the Bible directs us in our quest to become mature Christians, complete Christians, with this: add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and beyond knowledge right the way through to love. God wants us to be committed to pursuing truth. Truth cannot be established without gaining understanding and without a serious commitment of inquiring, a willingness to adjust our point of view, and even adjust our way of life. God wants us to be committed to pursuing truth. Truth cannot be established without gaining understanding, without a serious commitment of inquiry and a willingness to adjust our point of view and even our way of life as we gain more information. One of the saddest, probably the most pitiable persons in the world is the person who thinks they know it all, who thinks that they've grasped all truth and the implications of that truth. I think that growing up means we realise that we know less than we thought we used to know, that we can't be arrogant. So what is the way to this knowledge that would lead us to the completion God desires in us? Philippians 3 verse 10 says, I want to know Christ, sharing in his death, so that I might attain the resurrection power in eternal new life. Do you want to be all that God wants you to be? Add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge. We've got to choose. We choose first to acknowledge God as he reveals himself in creation, in his living word and by his spirit. We choose second to the truth about yourself as the spirit brings to you a realization that you are a sinner, that I am a sinner. And choose then to know Christ, not only as a friend, which he is, but also as your Lord, who calls you to self-denial and service. Proverbs 1 verse 7 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and discipline. In the Message paraphrase, that verse reads like this: start with God. The first step in learning is bowing down to God. Only fools thumb their noses at such wisdom and learning. Genuine knowledge acknowledges the existence of greater minds and the existence of the divine. David declared, the fool says in his heart, there is no God. But we can't stop there. We've got to grow up. Up, or perhaps more, we need to grow up in maturity. Second, we commit to allowing the Holy Spirit to teach us about ourselves. The other day I saw the youngest member of our fellowship here, just about 10 or 12 weeks old, that's all. Social distancing was in place. She was actually sat in her car seat, in the back seat of the car, and she was playing with her own feet. She was quite happy and perfectly content. And in much the same way that a baby discovers their nose and their toes along the road to maturity, we can only grow in spirituality and spiritually as we begin to allow the truth about ourselves to become part of our conscious understanding. It can be painful to see ourselves through God's eyes. The Holy Spirit speaks to us. The lives of Christians around us, holy Christians around us, convict us, and the truth of the Bible confronts us with the realization of our sinfulness. What we once excused as just my personality or my hang-up gains a new definition when we start to know ourselves truthfully. Paul was blunt in his self-description. Romans 7 says, I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature, for I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. Now, please don't misread that as meaning that you are worthless. Sinful, yes, but worthless, no way. You are of value and precious to God. The answer, in fact, as the Spirit shows us our sinfulness, is it should drive us to the good news that is the core of Christianity, deeper and deeper into that. That completeness comes when we know Christ. Romans 8 verses 1-2 is our cry of victory. There is no condemnation. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. Christians talk a lot about knowing Jesus. The language we use implies that we know him like knowing a friend. It's one of our favourite phrases. There's nothing wrong with the language, but to conceive that knowing Christ only in terms of that kind of friendship level will not lead us deeper in maturity and in our service. Choosing to know God involves a willingness to make decisions of commitment. I am concerned that when most of us talk about knowing Christ, we mean that we want friendship, not that we want to be mastered. That we want a friend, not a boss, not a lord. Is that your desire? I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow to attain the resurrection from the dead. Philippians 3. We've got to grow up, or perhaps more. We've got to grow in spiritual maturity and wisdom and depth.
Gently call me into your presence.
as we finish our time of reflection today, I want to pray a prayer, a blessing that is familiar to many of us, the one that I've used many times here at Croydon Salvation Army. Let's pray together. This is the God we adore, our faithful, unchangeable friend, whose love is as great as his power, which knows neither measure nor end. It's Jesus, the first and the last, whose spirit shall guide us safe home. We'll praise him for all that is past. And Lord Jesus, we're going to trust you for all that's to come.